Welcome back to Learning Journal. This video is the last item in the Spark SQL series. In this concluding video, I'll talk about following things. Spark SQL data types, Spark SQL metadata, Spark SQL functions, and user-defined functions. Let's start with the Spark SQL data types. As on date, if you Google for the Spark SQL data types, you won't be able to find a suitable document with a list of SQL data types and appropriate information about them. I mean, I was expecting something like Hive data type document. However, I couldn't find anything similar for Apache Spark SQL. The best thing that I saw was the documentation for org.apache.spark.sql.types package. So, let's look at the same. Here is the list of Spark SQL data types. These are all Scala classes. Most of them also have a companion object. And this is the best place to look for the supported data types. However, you cannot use them in SQL with these names. But you can find the SQL compatible names for these classes. Most of them have a static method to give you the equivalent name for SQL. For example, shorttype.sql gives you a small int. Similarly, stringtype.sql gives you a string. datetype.sql gives you date. And timestamptype.sql gives you timestamp. You also have a varchar type. Try varchar type of 10.sql and it gives you varchar 10. Similarly, decimaltype.sql gives you decimal. So, when you are creating a table in Spark SQL and looking for a list of supported data types and some more details about the supported types, this is the place where you will find the answer. Great! The next item on my list is the metadata. You already know what the metadata means, right? Let me quickly refresh your knowledge. If you have been using traditional databases like Oracle or any other RDBMS like MySQL or PostgreSQL, you must have used the data dictionary or the metadata. In most of the databases, the dictionary is a read-only set of tables that provide information about the database objects. A typical data dictionary contains information as listed below. Object definitions, column names and data types, partitions, location, and other statistics. The data dictionary is primarily used by administrators and developers when they want to get some details about the database objects. I've also seen some operations teams using metadata information for developing a bunch of scripts to automate their day-to-day monitoring and investigation work. But all that is not the real purpose of the metadata store. The data dictionary views are the byproduct. The real purpose of metadata store is much more fundamental. What is that? A SQL compiler can't work without a metadata store. When you write a select star from table 1, the compiler doesn't know what the table 1 is. Where is the data stored? How to read and interpret it? All those answers are hidden in the metadata store. And that's the real purpose of the metadata store. So, an SQL compatible database needs a metadata store. And hence the Spark SQL also needs one. Right? The creators of Spark decided to reuse the Hive metadata store instead of developing a new one. That means Spark comes with a bundled Hive meta store. However, you might already have a Hive cluster with a functioning Hive meta store. Now you want to bring the Spark into your ecosystem. And that requirement causes two types of challenges. The version of your existing Hive meta store might be different than the one that comes with your Spark. You might want to use a central meta store across your different clusters. The central store allows you to access your tables from all the clusters. The first point is clear. I don't think there is any confusion on the first point. However, if you haven't seen complex cluster deployments in a cloud environment, you might have some doubts about the second point. Let's try to understand that. Assume I already have a cluster setup in cloud environment. I have already integrated a bunch of technologies to design this cluster. I have a Yarn cluster with Apache Hive and Spark as well. I also have a Hive Metastore. The Hive Metastore is common for Spark and Hive. However, I am storing my data files in S3 bucket. And I have created Spark SQL tables using those data files. Now, I have a new requirement. I want to execute a machine learning model using the data that I already have. Model needs a lot of CPU and GPU resources. And I don't have that kind of machines in this existing cluster. So I decided to spin a new Spark cluster with high-end CPU and GPU resources. Since I am keeping my data in the S3 bucket, I can easily access those data files from this new cluster as well. However, the table definitions on those data files are stored in my existing metastore. The default metastore of the new cluster doesn't have those definitions. So if I try to execute the select star from my table, I'll get an error as the table does not exist. How would you fix that? There are two ways. Execute all the create table scripts in this cluster. And I guess that's a foolish thing to do. The other alternative is to reconfigure the new cluster to point to the earlier metastore. Even if you have 10,000 table definitions and hundreds of user-defined functions, all of them will be available to you in this new cluster without re-executing those DDLs in this new cluster. In a large organization, the need for spinning a new cluster keeps arriving that forces you to plan for a central metadata store. The configuration and setup a central metadata store is not within the scope of this tutorial. So we leave that part and move on to the method for accessing the metadata using Spark. Once you understand the importance of metadata, the next question is how to access it. There are two methods to access the metadata, SQL and API. You are already familiar with the SQL method. It is all about using the describe and the show commands, right? Both of these commands work with database, table, partition, and functions. The show command is to get a list of the objects. For example, show databases, show tables in my database, show create table, show columns in. Similarly, the describe command is used to get the details about an object. For example, describe database, describe table. Describe table extended. Most of these are documented in Databricks Spark SQL user guide. The second method to access the metadata information is using APIs. As on date, you can see a list of 5 classes in the org Apache Spark SQL catalog package. You should be able to find an equivalent API for all the show and describe commands in the catalog package. Let's look at some examples. This API gives you a dataset for the list of all databases. You can display the list using the show method. You can collect it back to the master node as a Scala array. Then you can loop through the array and apply a function on each element. Let's apply the println. The point that I want to make is this. The API gives you the metadata as a distributed collection. You can convert it into a local array or list. And that offers a lot of flexibility in the hand of a programmer. Great. Let's try to get the details of a column. Well, that shows a lot of things. I am looking to get a list of column name and the data type. That's it. And also, I want to sort the list by the column names. That's an easy thing to do. Here is the code. Great, I leave you there. You can look at the documentation and explore the variety of those catalog APIs. In fact, you can do anything that you want to do with the metadata. Great. The next item on my list is the SQL functions. If you have been working with SQL, you already know that the SQL functions comes in three flavors: standard function, aggregate function, and table functions. The standard functions are the most straightforward. These functions transform values from a single row within a table, and they produce a single corresponding output value per row. For example, an upper function returns an uppercase version of the input string. If the desired functionality is not available, you can define your own custom functions, and we call them a user-defined function or UDF. Implementing such UDFs is a straightforward thing. I'll show you some examples. The next category is for the aggregate functions. These functions act on multiple rows at once, but they return a single value as a result. Such functions typically work together with the group by statement. For example, the sum function that returns the total of the input value for all the rows in the given group. If you do not have a required functionality, you can implement a custom aggregate function as well, and we call them a user-defined aggregate function or a UDAF. Creating a UDAF is little more complicated, but nothing to worry. I'll show you an example for this as well. The final category is the table functions. These are like a standard function that accepts values from a single row, but they produce multiple corresponding output values per row. For example, an explode function that takes an array and returns each element of the array as an independent value. So these functions are known for producing multiple rows against each row from the table. Apache Spark, as on date, doesn't have direct support for implementing such custom functions. However, Hive supported creating such table functions, and we can call them as user-defined table functions or UDTF. As you already know that Spark SQL maintains a healthy relationship with Hive. So, it allows you to import and use all types of Hive functions to Spark SQL. What does that mean? That means, if you already have a Java or a Scala implementation for a bunch of Hive UDFs, you don't have to re-implement them for Spark SQL. You can package them in a jar and use them in Spark SQL. I am expecting that the future releases of Spark SQL will start supporting UDTF implementation. However, if you need a UDTF as on date, you can implement it in Hive and use it in Spark. I'll create example for Spark UDF, UDAF and Hive UDTF and also explain the details in the next video, as those details requires a separate focus. However, if you want to get a list of all available Spark SQL functions, you can refer to Spark SQL documentation. Alternatively, you can directly execute show functions command. If you want to get some more details about a function, you can describe a specific function. Great! That's it for this session. See you again in the next video. Keep learning and keep growing.